prince is this?
This is Illyria, lady.
And what should I do in Illyria? My brother, he is in Elysium. Perchance he is not drowned, but think you saved.
It is perchance that you yourself are saved.
Oh, my poor brother. And so perchance may he be.
True, madam, and to comfort you with chance, assure yourself, after our ship did split, when you and those poor numbers saved you hung on our dragon boat, I saw your brother, most provident in peril, find himself, courage and hope, both teaching him the practice. Like Arian on a dolphin's back, I saw him hold acquaintance with the seas, so long as I could see.
For saying so, there's gold. Mine own escape and folded to my hope, whereto thy speech serves for authority the life of it. Knowest thou this country?
I am, for I was born and born, and 3 hours travel from this very place.
Who governs here?
A noble duke, in nature, as a name.
What is his name?
Orsino.
If music be the food of love, play on. Give me excess of it, that, surfeiting the appetite, that it may sicken and so die. That strain, again it had a dying fall. It came o'er my ear like the sweet sound that breathes upon a bank of violets, stealing and giving odor. Enough! No more. 'Tis not so sweet as it was before. Oh, spirit of love, how quick and fresh art thou, that notwithstanding thy capacity receiveth as the sea, not enters there, what validity and pitch soe'er, but falls into abatement and low price, even in a minute. So full of shapes is fancy that it alone is high, fantastical. Oh, when mine eyes did see Olivia first, methought she purged the air of pestilence. In that instant was I turned into a heart. My desires, like fell and cruel hounds, e'er since pursue me. Away before me, to sweet beds of flowers, love thoughts lie rich and canopied with bowers.
Orsino, I have heard my father name him. He was a bachelor then.
As is now, or was so very late, for but a month ago I went from hence. And then 'twas fresh in her, as you know, with the grateful due, the less of proud to love, that he did seek the love of fair Olivia.
What's she?
A virtuous maid, the daughter of a count, who died some 12 months back, leaving her in the protection of his son, her brother, who shortly also died for whose dear love. They say she hath adjured the sight and company of men.
The element itself till 7 years' heat shall not behold my face at ample view. But like a cloistress, I will veil and walk, in water once a day, my chamber round, with eye offending bride. All this to season a brother's dead love, which I would keep fresh and lasting in my remembrance.
Oh, that I served that lady, and might not be delivered to the world till I made my own occasion mellow what my estate is.
That would hurt a compass, for she will admit no kind of suit. No, not the Duke's.
There is a fair behavior in thee, Captain, and though that nature with a beauteous wall doth off close with pollution, yet in thee I will believe that thou hast a mind that suits with this thy fair and outward character. I prithee, and I'll pay thee bounty. Conceal me what I am, and be my aid for such disguise as haply shall become the form of my intent. I'll serve this duke. Thou shalt consider me as an eunuch to him. It may be worth thy pains, for I can sing and speak to him in many sorts of music that will allow me very worth his service. What else may hap? To time I will commit. Only shape thou thy silence to my wit.
Be you his eunuch, your mute I'll be, when my tongue blabs, let my eyes not see.
things my niece to take the death of her brother thus. I'll stay here so I need life.
By my troth, Sir Toby, you must come in earlier at night. Your cousin, my lady, takes great exception to your ill hours.
Why let her accept before accepting?
Either you must confine yourself within the modest limits of order.
Confine? Not confine myself to any finer than I am. These clothes are good enough to drink in, and these boots too. And be they not, let them hang themselves by their own straps.
That quaffing and drinking will undo you. I heard my lady talk of it yesterday, and of a foolish knight that you brought in one night here to be her wooer.
Who's Sir Andrew Adichie? Why, he makes 3,000 ducats a year.
I bet he'll have but a year in all these ducats. He's a very fool and a prodigal.
Well, fie on you to say so. He doth play a viol to canvas. He speaks 3 or 4 languages, word for word, without a book, and hath all the other gifts of nature.
He hath indeed almost natural, for besides that he's a fool, he's a great quarreler. And but that he hath the gift of a coward to allay the gust he hath in quarreling, 'tis thought among the prudent he would quickly have the gift of a brave.
Well, they are scoundrels and subtractors that say so. Who are they?
They that add, moreover, he's drunk nightly in your company.
With drinking health to my niece. I will drink health to my niece as long as there is passage in my throat and drink in Illyria. He is a coward and a coistrel that will not drink to my niece's health till his brain turn the toe like a perished top. Oh, speak of the devil. Here comes Sir Andrew Agnew. Face.
Sir Toby Belch, come out, Sir Toby Belch.
Sweet Sir Andrew!
Bless you, fair shrew.
You too, sir. Fare you well, gentlemen.
And you part so, mistress. I would have never brought drawn sword again. Fair lady, do you think you have fools in hand?
Sir, I have not you by the hand.
Marry, but you shall have. And here's my hand.
Knight, I lack a cup of the canary. When did I see thee so down?
Never in your life, I think. Unless you see the canary put me down. You think sometimes I have no more wit than a Christian or an ordinary man has. But I am a great eater of beef, and I believe that does harm to my wit.
No question.
And I thought that, I forswear it. I'll ride home tomorrow, Sir Toby.
All for quoi, Sir Knight?
What is for quoi? Do or not do? I would I have bestowed that time in the tongues that I had in fencing and dancing and bear baiting. Oh, had I but followed the arts!
Well, have thou had an excellent head of hair?
Why, would that have mended my hair?
Well, past question, for you see it doth not curl by nature.
But it does become me well enough, does it not?
Excellent. It hangs like flax from a distaff. I hope to see a housewife take it between her legs and spin it off.
Maid, go home tomorrow, Sir Toby. Your niece will not be seen, and if she be, it's 4 to 1 and none of me. The Count himself here hard by woos her.
Oh, she'll none of the Count. She'll not match above her degree in estate, years, or wit. I heard her swear it. Tut, man, there's life in it.
I'll stay a month longer. I am the strangest man in the world, and I delight in masks and revels altogether.
And how art thou at these kickshaws, Sir Knight?
As any man, Illyria, whatsoever you be, and the degree of my betters, and yet I will not be compared to an old man.
And how art thou at a galliard, Sir Knight?
Faith, I can cut a caper.
And I can cut a mutton to it.
And I can back trick simply as strong as any man in Illyria.
Well, wherefore are these gifts hid? Wherefore have these gifts a curtain drawn before them? Are they like to take dust like Mistress Mole's portrait? My very walk would be a jig. Why dost thou not go to the church in a galliard, but come home in a coranto? I would not make as much water, but at a sink. A pace. What dost thou mean? Is the world to hide virtues in? I did think, by the excellent constitution of your lad, that it had to have been formed under the star of the galliard.
Aye, 'tis strong, and it does it different well in a dun-colored stock. Shall we set about some revels?
What else are we to do? Were we not born under the Taurus?
Taurus, that's sides and heart.
No, it is legs and thighs, Sir Knight. Legs and thighs, come, let us caper. Yes.
call Cesario home?
On your attendance, my lord. Here.
Oh. Stand you a while aloof. Cesario, thou knowest no less but all. I have unclasped to thee the book, even of my secret soul. Therefore, good youth, address thy gate unto her. Be not denied access. Stand at her doors. Tell them there thy fixed foot shall grow till thou have audience.
Sure, my noble lord. If she be so abandoned to her sorrow, as it is spoke, she never will admit me.
Be clamorous. Leap all civil bounds, rather than make unprofited return.
Say I do speak with her, my lord. What then?
Then unfold the passion of my love. Surprise her with discourse of my dear faith. It will become thee well to act my woes. She will attend it better in thy youth than in nuncios of more grave aspect.
I think not so, my lord.
Dear lad, believe it, for they shall yet belie thy happy years that say thou art a man. Diana's lip is not more smooth and rubious. And thy small pipe is as maiden's organ, shrill in sound. And all the semblance of a woman's part. I know thy constellation is right apt for this affair. Prosper well in this, and thou shalt live as freely as thy lord to call his fortunes thine.
I'll do my best to woo you, lady. Yet a barful strife. Whoe'er I woo, myself would be his wife.
Shake him.
Infirmity that decay the wise doth ever make the better fool.
God send you, sir, a speedy infirmity for the better increasing of your folly. Sir Toby will be sworn that I am no fox, but he will not pass for twopence that you are no fool.
Ooh, what say you to that, Pavolia?
I marvel that your ladyship take delight in such a barren rascal. Why, I saw him put down the other day with an ordinary fool that hath no more brain than a stone. Look you now, he's on his guard already. Unless you lack a minister occasion to him, he is gagged. I must protest, I take these wise men that crow so at these set kinds of fools, at these fools' sayings.
Oh, you are sick of self-love and taste with a distempered appetite. To be generous, guiltless, and a free disposition is to take those things for bird bolts which you deem cannon bullets. There is no slander in an allowed fool, though he do nothing but rail, nor no railing in an undiscreet man, though he do nothing but prove.
Now Mercury endue thee with reason, thou speakest well of fools.
Madam, there is at the gate a young gentleman much desires to speak with you.
From the Count Orsino, is it?
I know not, madam. Tis a fair young man and well attended.
Who of my people hold him in delay?
Sir Toby, madam, your kinsman.
Fetch him off, I pray you. He speaks nothing but madman. Fie on him. Go you, Malvolia. If it be a suit from the Count, I am sick or not at home. What you will to dismiss it. Now you see, sir, how your fooling grows old and people dislike it.
Thou hast spoke well for us, Madonna, as if thy eldest son should be a fool, who scolds your crab with brains for... Hey, here it comes. One of thy kin has a most weak pile mater.
By my honor, half drunk. What is he at the gate, cousin?
Oh, tis a gentleman.
A gentleman? What gentleman?
Oh, there's a gentleman that... Oh, oh. Oh, plague on these pickled herrings. Oh, how now, son?
Good sir, Toby.
Cousin, how came you so early by this lethargy?
Lechery? I defy lechery. Oh, there's one at the gate.
Aye, Mary, what is he?
Let it be the devil any will, I care not. Give me faith, says I. Well, it's all one.
What is a drunken man like, fool?
Like a drowned man, a fool, and a madman. First draught above heat makes him the fool. The second, mads him. And the third, drowns him.
Well, go seek the crowner and let him sit, oh my cuz. For he is in the third degree of drink. He's drowned. Go look after him.
He is but mad, Madonna, and the fool shall look to the madman.
Madam, yon young fellow swears he will speak with you. I tell him you are sick. He takes upon him to understand so much and comes to speak with you. I say you are asleep. He seems to have foreknowledge of that shoe and comes to speak with you. What is to be said to him? He's fortified against any denial.
Tell him. He shall not speak with me.
Has been told so, and says he'll stand at your door like a sheriff's post and become supporter to a bench, but he'll speak with you.
What kind of man is he?
Of mankind.
What manner of man?
Of very ill manner. He'll speak with you, will you or no?
Of what personage in years is he?
Not yet old enough for a man, nor young enough for a boy. Like a squash is, 'tis before a pea is caught, or a codling, 'tis when almost an apple. It is with him in standing water between boy and man. He is very well favored and speaks very shrewishly. One would think his mother's milk were scarce out of him.
Let him approach. Call in my gentlewoman.
Gentlewoman, my lady calls!
Give me my veil. Come, throw it over my face. We'll once more hear Orsino's embassy.
The honorable lady of the house,
which is she? Speak to me, I shall answer for her. Your will.
Most radiant, exquisite, and unmatchable beauty, I pray you tell me if this be the lady of the house, for I never saw her. I would be loath to cast away my speech, for besides that it is excellently well kinned, I have taken great pains to con it. Good beauties, let me sustain no scorn. I'm very comfortable even to the least sinister usage.
Whence came you, sir?
I can say little more than I have studied, and that question's out of my heart.
Good gentlewoman, give me modest assurance if you be the lady of the house that I may proceed in my speech.
Are you a comedian?
No. My profound heart, and yet by the very face of malice, I swear I am not that I play. Are you the lady of the house?
Will you hoist sail, sir? Here lies your way.
No, Fitzwalber, I am to hold here a little longer. Some mollification for your giant, sweet lady.
Tell me your mind.
I am a messenger.
Give us the place alone. We will hear this divinity. Now, what is your text?
Most sweet lady.
Oh, a comfortable doctrine, and much may be said of it. Where lies your text?
In Orsino's bosom.
In his bosom? In what chapter of his bosom?
To answer by the method in the first of his heart.
Oh, I have read it. It is heresy. Have you no more to say?
Good madam, let me see your face.
Have you permission from your lord to negotiate with my face? You are now out of your text, but we will draw the curtain and show you the picture. Look you now, sir. Such a one I was this present. Is it not well done?
Excellently done. If God did all.
'Tis ingrained, sir. 'Twill endure wind and weather.
'Tis beauty truly blent, whose red and white nature's own sweet and cunning hand laid on. Lady, you are the cruelest she alive, and you are to lead these graces to the grave and leave the world no copy.
Oh, I will not be so hard-hearted. I will give out divers schedules of my beauty in every particle and label to my will as item, two lips in different red. Item, two gray eyes with lids to them. Item, one neck, one chin, and so forth. Were you sent hither to praise me?
I see what you are. You're too proud. But if you were the devil, you were fair. My lord and master loves you. Ooh, such love could be but recompense, though you were crowned the nonpareil of beauty.
How does he love me?
With adorations, fertile tears, with groans that thunder, with sighs of fire.
Your lord does know my mind. I cannot love him. Yet I suppose him virtuous, know him noble, of great estate, of fresh and stainless youth, in voices well divulged, free, learned, and valiant, and in the dimension and shape of nature, a gracious person. But yet, I cannot love him. He might have took his answer long ago.
If I did love you and my master's flame, with such a suffering, such a deadly life, in your denial I would find no sense, I would not understand it.
Why, what would you?
Make me a willow cabin at your gate and call upon my soul within the house. Write loyal cantons of contented love and sing them loud, even in the dead of night. Halloo your name to the reverberant hills, and make the babbling gossip of the air cry out, Olivia! Ooh, you should not rest between the elements of air and earth, but you should pity me.
You might do much. What is your parentage?
Above my fortune, yet my state as well. I am a gentleman.
Get you to your lord. Let him send no more. I cannot love him. Unless perhaps you were to come to me again to tell me how he takes it. Fare thee well. I thank you for your pains. Spend this for me.
I am no thief, post lady. Keep your purse. My master, not myself, lacks recompense. Love make his heart a fervor that you shall love. And let your fervor, like my master's, be placed in content. Farewell, fair cruelty.
What is your parentage? Above my fortunes, yet my estate is well. I am a gentleman. Oh, I'll be sworn thou art thy tongue, thy limbs, thy actions, body, spirit, do give me fivefold blazon. Not too fast, soft, soft, unless the master were the man. How now, even so quickly may one catch the plague? Methinks I feel this youth's perfections with an invisible and subtle stealth to creep in at mine eye. Well, let it be. What ho, Malvolia?
Here, madam, at your service.
I'll run after that same peevish messenger, the Count's man. He left this ring behind him, would I or not, I'll none of it, and desire him not to flatter his lord nor hold him up with hopes I am not for him. And if that youth were to come again tomorrow, I'll give him reasons for it. Hide thee, Malvolia.
Madam, I will.
I do not know what, and fear to find, mine eye too great a flatterer for my mind. Fate, show thy force. Ourselves we do not owe. What is decreed must be, and be this so.
Will you stay no longer, nor will you not that I go with you?
By your patience, no. My stars shine darkly over me. The malignancy of my fate might distemper yours. Therefore, I crave of you your leave, that I may bear these evils alone.
Let me yet know of you whither you are bound.
No, sooth, sir. My determinate voyage is mere extravagancy. But I detect in you so excellent a touch of modesty that you will not extort from me that which I am willing to keep in. Therefore, it charges me in a manner the rather to express myself. You must know me, then, Antonio. My name is Sebastian, that which I call Rodrigo. My father is that Sebastian of Messaline, whom I know you have heard. He left behind him myself and a sister, both born in an hour. And had the heavens been so pleased, would we had so ended, but you, sir, altered that. For within the hour that you rescued me from the breach of the sea was my sister drowned.
Alas, the day.
Oh, lady, sir! Though it was said she much resembled me, was yet accounted by many beautiful. But though I could not with such estimable wonder over far believe that, yet thus far I will boldly publish her. She bore a mind that envy in itself could not help to call fair. Still, sir, she is drowned with salt water. Though I seem to drown her remembrance again and more.
Pardon me, sir, a bad entertainment.
Oh. Good Antonio, forgive me your trouble.
If you will not murder me for my love, let me be your servant.
If you will not undo that which you have done, that is, kill him whom you have recovered, desire it not. Fare you well at once. My bosom is so full of kindness, and yet I am so near the manners of my mother that upon the least occasion more, mine eyes shall tell tales of thee. I am bound to the Count Orsino's court. Farewell.
May the gentleness of all the gods go with thee. Many enemies in Orsino's court, else I would shortly see thee there. But come what may, I do adore thee so that danger shall seem sport, and I shall go.
Were you now even with the Countess Olivia?
Even now, I am on a moderate pace I have since her ride's but hither.
She returns this ring to you, sir. You might have saved me my pains to have taken it away yourself.
She adds, moreover, that you should put your lord into a desperate assurance, show none of him. And one thing more, that you never be so hardy to come again in his affairs unless it is to report your taking of this. Receive it so.
She took the ring of me. I'll none of it.
Ugh, come, sir. You peevishly threw it to her, and her will is it should be so returned. There. If it be worth stooping for, it lies in your eye. If not, let it be his that finds it.
She hath no ring with me. What means this lady? Fortune forbid my outside had that charm for her. She made good view of me. Indeed, so much methought her eyes had lost her tongue, for she did speak and starts distractedly.
She loves me, sure. The cunning of her passion invites me in this churlish messenger.
None of my lord's ring.
Why he sent her none?
I am the man.
If it be so as 'tis, poor lady. She would better love a dream.
Disguise, I see thou art a wickedness wherein the pregnant enemy does much. How easy is it for the proper false in women's waxen hearts to set their forms?
Alas, our frailty is the cause, not we. For such we are made of, such we be.
How will this badge? My master loves her dearly, and I, poor monster, fond on him as much. And she, mistaken, seems to dote on me.
steed is desperate for my master's love. As I am woman, now alas the day. What thriftless sighs shall poor Olivia breathe?
Oh, time! Thou must untangle this, not I, for 'tis too hard a knot for me to untie.
Disposed,
And so do I, but he has much better grades, but I do it more natural.
On the 12th day of December!
For the love of God, peace! My masters, are you mad or what are you? Have you no wit, manners, nor honesty, but to gabble like tinkers at this time of night? Do you make an alehouse of my lady's house and squeak out your coachers' catches without any remorse of voice or mitigation? Have you no respect of place, persons, nor time in you?
We did keep time in our catches well enough.
Back up.
Speak out with you, Sir Toby. My lady bade me tell you that though she harbors you as her kinsman, she is nothing allied to your disorders. So do you separate yourself and your misdemeanors, you are welcome to the house. If not, and it will please you to take leave of her, she is more than willing to bid you farewell.
Farewell, dear heart, for I must be
Sir Toby.
His eyes you show, his days are almost gone.
Yes, even so.
But I will never die.
Oh, Sir Toby, there you lie.
This is much credit to you.
Shall I bid her go?
Once, and if you do,
shall I bid her go and spare not?
Oh, no, 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 you dare not!
Out of tune, sir, you lie. Art thou more than a steward? Dost thou think, because thou art so virtuous, that there will be no more cakes and ale?
Yes, by St. Anne, ginger shall be hot in the mouth, too!
Better in the right of it. Go, sir, brush thy chain with crumbs. Another stoup of wine, Maria?
Mistress Mary, if you held my lady's favor in anything more than contempt, you would not give me to this uncivil rule. She shall know of it by this hand.
Go shake your ears!
Possess us, tell us something of her.
Mary, sir, sometimes she's a kind of Puritan.
Oh, well, if I thought that, I'd beat her like a dog!
What, for being a Puritan? Thy exquisite reason, Sir Knight?
I have no exquisite reason for it, but I have reason well enough.
The devil, a Puritan that she is, or anything constantly but a time pleaser. An affectioned ass that constate with outlook and utters it by great swaths. The best persuaded of herself, so crowned as she thinks, with excellencies, that it is her grounds of faith, that all that look upon her love her. And on that vice in her will my revenge find notable cause to work.
What wilt thou do?
I will drop in her way some obscure epistles of love, wherein by the color of her beard, the shape of her leg, the manner of her gait, the expression of her eye, forehead, and complexion, she shall find herself most feelingly personated. I can write very well like my lady, your niece. On a forgotten matter, we can hardly make distinction of our hands.
I smell a device.
I have it in my nose, too.
She will think from letters that thou wilt drop that they come from my niece, and that my niece is in love with her.
My purpose is indeed a horse of that color.
And nor would thou make her an ass.
Ass, I doubt not.
Good night, Penthesilia.
Before me. She's a good wench.
Aye, she's a beagle true bred. She adores me, and what of that?
I was once adored too.
Come, Sir Knight. It is late. Let us to bed. Thou hast need send for more money tomorrow. Oh, I'll go burn some sacks. It's far too late to go to bed now. Come, Sir Knight. Come, Sir Knight.
Give me some music.
Ah, now good morrow, friends.
And play the tune the while. Come hither, boy. If ever thou thou shalt love, and the sweet pangs of it, remember me. For such as I am, all true lovers are, unstayed, skittish, in all motions else, save in the constant image of the creature that is beloved. How dost thou like this tune?
It gives a very echo to the sea where love is thrown.
Oh, thou dost speak masterly. My life upon't, young though thou art, thine eye hath stayed upon some favor, hath it not, boy?
A little in your favor.
Well, what kind of woman is?
Of your complexion.
Well, she is not worth thee then. Now, what years he faith?
About your years, my lord.
Too old, by heaven. Let still the woman take an elder than herself. So wears she to him, so sways she level in her husband's heart. For boy, however we do fancy ourselves, our fancies are far more giddy, unfirm, more longing, wavering, sooner lost, worn, than women's are.
I think it well, my lord.
Then let thy love be younger than thyself, or thy affections cannot hold the bent. And for women are as roses, whose fair flower, being once displayed, doth fall that very hour.
And so they are, alas, they are so, to die, even when they do
mention girls. Fellow, the song from last night. Are you ready, sir?
Aye. Prithee, sing.
Come away, death, and in sad Cyprus let me be laid. Fly away, breath, I've been slain by a fair cruel maid. My shroud of white stuck over you, oh, prepare.
Gems that nature pranks her and attracts my soul.
But if she cannot love you, sir?
I cannot be answered.
Sooth, but you must. Say that some lady, as perhaps there is, hath as great a pang of heart as you do for Olivia. You cannot love her. You tell her so. Must she not then be answered?
There is no woman's sides can bide the beating of so strong a passion that love doth give my heart. No woman's heart so big to hold so much. Alas, their love may be called appetite. No motion of the liver, but the palate that suffers surfeits, cloyment, and revolt. But mine is all as hungry as the sea, and can digest as much. Make no compare between that love a woman can bear me, and that I owe Olivia.
Aye, but I know.
What dost thou know?
Too well what love women to men may owe. In faith, they are as true of heart as we. My father had a daughter loved a man, as it might be. Were I a woman, I should, your lordship.
What's her history?
A blank, my lord. She never told her love, but let concealment, like a worm in the bud, feed on her damask cheek. She pinned in thought, with a green and yellow melancholy, she sat like patience on a monument, smiling at grief. Was this not love indeed? We men may say more, swear more, but indeed our shows are more than will, for still we prove much in our vows, but little in our love.
But died thy sister of her love, my boy?
I am all the daughters of my father's house, and all brothers too. And yet I know not. Sir, shall I do this, lady?
Aye, that's the theme. To her in haste. Give her this jewel. Say, my love, give no place. Bide no delay.
Of her the crease of which she doth uses to seal. To whom should this be?
This Windsor liver and all.
Jove knows our love, but who? Lips do not move, no man must know. No man must know. The numbers altered, no man must know. It should, if it should be thee, Melville, be thee.
Oh, Mary, hang thee, rock.
I may command where I adore, but silence, like a Lucrece knife, with bloodless stroke my heart doth gore. M-O-A-I doth sway my life.
A fishy riddle.
Excellent, wench.
M-O-A-I doth sway my life. Nay, but first, let me see.
What does your poison that she dressed her?
I make up that. Now she's at consent.
Sodder will cry upon me for all this. Though it be rank as a fox.
M. Malvolia. Did that begin my name?
Did not I say she would work it out? The cur is excellent at faults.
M. But there is no... But there's no constancy in the sequel that follows under probation. A should follow where O does.
And O shall end, I hope.
I will cudgel thee and make thee cry, O.
And I comes behind.
Aye, and you had an eye behind you, you might see more detraction at your heels than fortunes before you.
M-O-A-I. This sequence is not as the former, and yet to crush this a little, it should bow up to me. For every one of these letters are in my name. Soft. He follows first. If this fall into thy hand, resolve. In my stars, I am above thee. But be not afraid of greatness. Some are born great. Some achieve greatness. And some have greatness thrust upon. Thy fates open their hands. Let thy blood and spirit embrace them. And to ensure thyself to what thou art like to be, cast thy humble slough and appear fresh. Be opposite with a kinsman, and surly with servants. Let thy tongue tame arguments of state. Put thyself into the trick of singularity. She thus advises thee, that sighs for thee. Remember who commanded thy yellow stockings, and wished to see thee ever cross garter. I say remember. Go to, thou art made, if thou desirest to be so. If not, let me see thee a steward still, the fellow of servants, and not worthy to touch fortune's fingers. Farewell, she that alters services with thee, the fortunate unhappy. I do not let excitement jade me, but every reason that points to this, that my lady loves me.
What's you?
Meow.
She did. Commend my yellow stockings of late, and did praise my leg being cross-gartered. And with this, she manifests herself to my love and pushes me to these habits of her liking. Jove, and my stars, I am happy. I will be strange, stout, in yellow stockings and cross-gartered, even with swiftness of putting on. Oh, here follows postscript. Thou canst not choose but know who I am. If thou entertain'st my love, let it appear in thy smiling. Thy smile becomes thee well. Therefore, in my presence, still smile. Dear my sweet, I prithee. Oh, I will smile. I will do everything that will happen.
She will come to her in yellow stockings, to the color Olivia abhors, and cross-gartered, a fashion Olivia detests, and she will smile upon her, which will now be so unsuitable to her disposition, being addicted to a melancholy as she is, that it cannot but turn her into a notable contempt. If you will see it, follow me.
To the gates of Tartarus, my most excellent devil's wit.
I did not want you to say it.
Music of the spheres, dear lady.
Give me leave.
beseech you, I did send, after the last enchantment you did here, a ring in chase of you. Did I abuse myself, my servant, and I fear me, you? Under your hard construction must I sit to force that on you in a shameful cunning which you knew none of yours. What might you think? Have you not baited my honor, placed my honor at the stake, and baited it with all the unmuzzled thoughts that tyrannous heart can think? To one of your receiving, enough is shown, a cypress. Not a bosom hides my heart, so let me hear you speak.
I pity you.
'Tis a degree to love.
No, not a bride, for to vulgar we pity enemies.
Why then, methinks 'tis time to smile again. Oh, world, how apt the poor are to be proud. If one were to be a prey, how much the better to fall before the lion than the wolf. The clock upbraids me with the waste of time. Oops. Fear not, good youth. I shall not have thee. And yet when wit and youth is come to harvest, your wife is like to reap a proper man. There lies your way, do best.
Thank you, I swear to hope. Grace and good disposition attend your ladyship.
You'll nothing, madam, to my lord by me.
Stay, I prithee, tell me, what dost thou thinkest of me?
That you do think you are not what you are.
If I think so, I think the same of you.
Think you right, I am not what I am.
I would you were as I would have you be.
Would it be better, madam, than I am? I wish it might, but now I am your fool.
Oh, what a great deal of scorn looks beautiful in the anger and contempt of his lip. A murderous guilt shows itself not more soon than love that would seem hid. Love's night is noon. Cesario, by the roses of the spring, by maidhood, honor, truth, and everything, I love thee so. And more all thy pride, nor writ, nor reason can my passion hide, and reason thus with reason better. A love sought is good, but given unsought is better.
By innocence, I swear, and by my youth, I have one heart, one bosom, and one truth that no mistress has, nor never none shall mistress be of it, save I alone. And so adieu, good madam, no more will I my master's tears to you deplore.
Yet come again, for thou perhaps mayest move that heart which abhors to like his lewd.
Ah, look, the youngest friend of mine comes.
If you desire the spleen of laugh yourself into stitches, follow me. Yon whom Apollo has turned heathen, a very renegado, for there is no Christian that means to be saved by believing rightly can ever believe such impossible passages of grossness. She's in yellow stockings.
Be cross-guarded.
Oh, spin in the sleeve.
Come, bring me to her.
I would not by my will have troubled you, but since you make pleasure of your pains, I will no further chide you.
Not stay behind you. My desire more sharp than Philip's field is for me for. And not all love, as though so much as might have drawn you to a longer voyage. But jealousy, what might befall you on your travels? Being friendless and skillless in these parts often prove rough and unhospitable. My willing love and these arguments of fear.
My kind Antonio, I can no answer make but thanks and thanks and ever thanks. And oft good turns are shuffled off with such uncurrent pay. But, for my worth, as is my conscience firm, you should find better company. What's to do? Shall we go see the relics of this town?
Best first go see your lodging.
I am not weary. The night is long. I pray you, let us satisfy our eyes with the monuments and things of fame that do renown this city.
I do not without danger walk these streets. Once in a sea fight against the Count and his galleys, I did some service, of such note indeed that if I were taken, I would scarce be answered.
Yeah, okay, belike you slew a great number of his people.
The offense was not such a bloody nature, albeit the time and quality of quarrel could have well given bloody offense. It might be in repaying what we took for them, which most of our city did, but if I be left in this place, I shall pay dear.
Do not then walk too open.
It doth not fit me. Hold, sir. Here's my purse. In the south suburbs that the elephant is best to lodge.
Why I your purse?
Happily your eye shall light upon some toy you have desired to purchase.
I'll be your purse bearer and leave you for an hour.
To the elephant.
I do remember.
I have sent for him. He says he'll come. How shall I feast him? What bestow of him? For youth is bought more oft than begged or borrowed. I speak too loud. Where is Malvolia? She is sad and civil and suits me well for a servant with my fortunes. Where is Malvolia?
She's coming, madam, but in a very strange manner. She's sure possessed, madam.
Why, what's the matter? Does she rave?
No, madam, she does nothing but smile. Your ladyship would best have some guard if she come, for sure the woman is tainted in her wits.
Well, go call her hither, for I am mad as she, if sad and merry madness equal be.
Sweet lady, ho-ho!
Smilest thou? I sent for thee upon a sad occasion. Sad lady, I could be sad. This does cause some obstruction of the blood, this cross-guardery, but what of that? If it please the eye of one, it is with me as the very true sonnet says, please one and please all.
Why, how dost thou, man? What is the matter with thee?
Not lacking my mind, although yellow in my legs, it is, well, I think we do know who holds the sweet Roman hand.
Wilt thou go to bed, Malvolia?
To bed? Aye, sweetheart, and I'll come to thee.
God comfort thee. Why dost thou smile so and kiss thy hand so oft?
How do you, Malvolia?
At your request, yes, nightingales answer dogs.
Why appear you with such ridiculous boldness before my lady?
Be not afraid of greatness. It was well writ.
What meanest thou by that, Malvolia?
Some are born great.
Huh?
Some achieve greatness.
What sayest thou?
And others have greatness thrust upon.
Heaven restore thee.
Go to, if thou desirest to be so.
Am I maid?
If not, let me see thee a servant still.
Oh, why, this is very midsummer madness. Good Maria, let Malvolia be looked to. Where is my cousin Toby? Have some of my people take special care of him. I would not have him miscarry for the half of my dowry.
Oh, ho, you come near me now. No worse man than Sir Toby to look to me. This occurs directly with the letter. She sends him on purpose so that I may appear stubborn to him. She incites me directly to this in the letter. Put thyself into the trick of singularity, says she. Be opposite with the kinsman and surly with servants. Let thy tongue tame with arguments of state and cast thy humble sloop. Consequently, she's set the manner as a sad face, a reverent carriage, a slow tongue, and in the of some surd note, and so forth. No. I blind her, but Jove's be paid, not I. And when she went away just now, let Malvolia be looked to. Not gorgeous, nor after my degree, but Malvolia. Why, it all adheres together. There is no dram of a scruple, no scruple of a scruple, nor obstacle, nor incredulous or unsafe circumstance. But it is Jove's doing, and Jove, not I, is to be thanked.
Where is she? In the name of the sanctity of all the devils can draw up quickly. The Legion himself has possessed her. I will see her.
Oh, here she is! Here she is! How is it with you, lady? Oh, how is it with you, madam?
Go off. I discard you. Let me enjoy my pipe. Go off.
How hollow the fiend speaks within her. Did not I tell you? Sir Toby, my lady prays you have a care of her.
Does she?
Go to. Peace. Let me alone with her. How do you, Malvolio? How is it with you? And,
oh, what? Oh!
To find the devil, consider he's an enemy to mankind.
Do you know what you're saying?
You speak ill of the devil, how she takes that heart. Pray God she be not bewitched.
Carry her water to the wise woman.
Mary, when it shall be done tomorrow, my lady will not lose her for more than I'll say.
Go hang yourselves all! You are idle, shallow beings. I am not of your element. You shall no more hereafter.
Is possible.
If this were played upon the stage now, I could condemn it as an improbable fiction.
Their very genius has taken the infection of the device.
Hey, pursue her now, lest the device take air and taint.
Why, we shall make her mad, indeed.
The house will be quieter.
Come. We will have her in a dark room and bound. My niece is already of the opinion she's mad. We will carry it thus for our pleasure and her penance till our very pastime, tired and out of breath, prompt us to have mercy upon her. At which point, we will take the device to the bar and crown thee a finder of madmen. Oh, let's see.
More metaphor in May morning.
Here's the challenge. Read it.
I warrant it. Vinegar, pepper, and
is it so saucy?
I warrant it.
Youth, whosoever thou art but a scurvy fellow.
Good and valiant.
Wonder not nor admire not in thy mind why I do call thee so, for I will show thee no reason for it.
A good note that keeps you from the blow of the law.
Now comes to the Lady Olivia, and in my sight she uses thee kindly, but thou liest in thy throat. That is not the matter I challenge thee for.
Very brief and to exceedingly good sense less.
I will waylay thee going home, or if it be thy chance to kill me.
Good.
Thou killst me like a rogue and a villain.
Still you keep on the windy side of the law. Good.
Fare thee well, and God have mercy upon one of our souls. He may have mercy upon mine, but my hope is better, and so look to thyself. Thy friend as thou usest him, and thy sworn enemy, Andrew... Aguecheek. Well, if this letter move him not, his legs cannot. Oh, I'll give it him.
You may have very fit occasion for it. He's now in some commerce with my lady. We'll by and by depart.
Nay, let me alone for swearing.
Oh, this letter, being so excellent, ignorant, it will bring no fear to you. People think it comes from a clodpole. But I will deliver a challenge by word of mouth. And heap upon Sir Andrew a notable report of valor. And drive the gentleman, as I'm sure his youth is apt to receive it, into such a horrible opinion of his rage, his fury, his anger, and his impetuosity. This will frighten them both, that they are like to kill each other with glances like cockatrices.
Oh, here he comes with your niece. Give them way till he take leave, and then presently after him.
I will meditate on some florid message.
I have said too much unto a heart of stone, and laid mine honor to untrue on it. There's something in me that reproves my fault, but such a headstrong, potent fault it is that it but mocks reproof. Here, wear this jewel for me. 'Tis my picture. Refuse it not, it hath no tongue to vex you. And I beseech you, come again tomorrow, for what shall you ask of me that I'll deny that my honor saved? May upon asking give.
Nothing but this. Your true love for my master.
But how can I give to him that which I have already given to you?
I will acquit you.
Oh, but come again tomorrow. Fare thee well. A fiend like thee might bear my soul to hell.
Oh, gentlemen, God save thee.
And you, sir?
What defense thou hast, take thee to it.
You mistake, sir. I'm sure no man hath any quarrel to me. My remembrance is very free and clear of any image of offense done to any man.
You'll find it otherwise, I assure you.
I pray you, sir, what is he?
He is a knight. Dubbed with unhatched rapier, and on carpet consideration. But he is a devil in a private duel. Souls and bodies hath he divorced three, And his incensement at this moment is so implacable that satisfaction can be none but the pains of death and sepulcher. No quarter is his word given or taken.
This is as uncivil as strange. I beseech you, do me this courteous office as to know the knight what my offense to him is. It is something of my negligence, nothing of my purpose.
I shall do so. Signor Fabian, will you stay with this gentleman until my return?
I pray you, sir, do you know of this matter?
I know the knight is incensed against you, even to a mortal arbitrament, but nothing of the circumstances more.
I beseech you, what manner of man is he?
Nothing of that wonderful promise to read him by his form, as you are like to find him in the proof of his valor. He is indeed the most skillful and bloody and fatal opposite you could have possibly found in any part of Illyria. Will you walk toward him? I will make your peace with him if I can.
I shall be much bound to you for it. I am one that I'd rather go with Sir Priest than Sir Knight. I care not who knows so much of my mettle.
Why, sir, he is a devil. I have not seen such a farrago. I made pass at him with scabbard and rapier and all, and he did give me such a mortal motion as is inevitable. And his answer, as sure as your feet hit the ground they stand on, he pays you. I heard he was Spencer from the Sophie.
Hoxon, I'll not meddle with him.
Well, he will not be placated now. See, your Fabian can scarce hold him yonder.
Plague on it. And I thought he had been so valiant and so cunning in fence. I have seen him damned ere, and I challenged him. Let him let the matter slip, and I'll give him my horse, Great Capulet.
I have got him to give up his horse for the quarrel. He thinks the youth's a devil.
He does horribly conceited of him, and he pants and looks pale as though a bear were at his heels.
Sir, there is no remedy. He will fight you for his honor's sake.
Pray God defend me. A little thing will tell them how much I lack of a man. Give ground if you see him furious.
Come, Sir Andrew. There is no remedy. But he has given me his word as a soldier and a gentleman. He will not hurt you. Come to it.
Pray God to keep his oath. I do assure you, 'tis against my will.
Put up your sword! This young gentleman hath done offense. I take fault unto me.
What are you? Who are you?
Oh, Sir Toby, hold. Here come the officers.
I'll be with you anon.
Pray you, sir, put up your sword if you please.
Very will I, sir. And for that I promise, I'll be as good as my word. You will bear you easily if it rains well.
This is the man. Do thy office.
Antonio, I arrest the unsuit of Count Orsino.
Do mistake me, sir.
No, sir, no jot. I know your favor well, though now you have no sea cap on your head. Take him away.
I must obey. This comes with seeking you. What will you do now? My necessity makes me to ask you for my purse. It grieves me much more for what I could not do for you than what befalls myself. You stand amazed, but be of comfort.
Come, sir, away.
I must entreat you some of that money.
What money, sir? For the fair kindness that you have shown me here, in part being prompted by your present trouble, I'll lend you something. My having is not much. I'll make division of my current with you. Hold, here's my comfort.
Will you deny me now? It's possible my deference to you can lack persuasion. Do not tempt me with my misery, lest it make me so unsound a man as to upbraid you with those kindnesses I have done for you.
I know of none. Nor I know you by voice or any feature. I hate ingratitude more in a man than lying, vainness, babbling, drunkenness, or anything of vice whose strong corruption inhabits our frail blood.
Oh, heavens themselves.
The time goes by, away.
How violent idle proof is God. Thou hast, Sebastian, done feature good shame. Oh, e'er flourished by the devil.
The man goes mad. Away. Come, sir, come.
Lead me on.
Methinks his words do from such passion fly, that he believes himself, so do not I. Ooh, prove true, imagination, ooh, prove true, that I, dear brother, be now tame for you.
Come, sir knight, come, senior baby, and we will whisper over this over a couplet or two of most sacred sauce.
He named Sebastian. I, my brother, know, yet living in my glass, even such and so. In favor was my brother, and he went in this color, fashion, ornament. Oh, if it prove, tempests are kind and it's always fresh and new.
Will you make me believe that I was not sent for you?
Go to, go to. Thou art a foolish fellow. Let me be clear of thee.
Well, how thou in faith? No, I do not know you. Nor was I not sent here by my lady Olivia for you to come back to speak with her. Nor your name is not Master Cesario. Nor that's not my real nose, neither. Nothing that is so is so.
I pray thee, vent thy folly someplace else. Thou knowest not me.
Vent my folly? He has heard this word of a great man and applies it to a fool. Vent my folly? I am afraid the great lover of the world will prove a cockney. I prithee thee, ungird thy strangers and tell me what I shall vent to my lady. Shall I vent to her that thou art coming?
I prithee, foolish Greek, depart from me. There's money for thee. You shall tarry longer, I shall give thee worse.
Thou hast an open hand! These wise men who do give fools good money do get themselves a good report in 14 years' purchase.
Now, sir, have I met you again? There's for you.
Well, there's for thee.
And thee. And thee.
Are all the people mad?
This I will tell my lady straight. I would not bring to be in some of your coats for 2 pence. But that, And if, but if?
To her, Master Parson.
What? Ho, I say, peace in this prison!
Main count as well, excellent name.
Who calls there?
Sir Topis the Curate, here who comes to visit Malvolia the Lunatic.
Oh, Sir Topis, Sir Topis, oh, good Sir Topis, please go to my lady.
Out, hyperbolical fiend! How thou vexest thou this woman? Talkest thou nothing but of ladies?
Well said, Master Parson.
Sir Topis, I am not mad. There was never woman thus wronged, good Sir Topis.
Aye. Thou dishonest Satan! I call thee among the most modest terms, for I am one of those gentle ones who use the devil himself with courtesy. Sayst thou the house is dark?
As hell, Sir Topis.
Why, it hath bay windows and transparent as barricadoes, and collateries towards north-south, as lustrous as ebony. And yet thou complainest of obstruction!
Sir Topis, I am not mad. I say to you, this house is dark.
Nay, I say there is no darkness, but ignorance. So much as art as the Egyptians in their fog.
Sir Topis, I say to you, this house is as dark as hell, though ignorance were as dark as hell. And I say, there was never woman thus abused. Make the trial of it in any constant question.
What is the opinion of Pythagoras concerning wildfowl?
That the soul of our grandson might haply inhibit a bird.
What thinkest thou of his opinion?
I think nobly of the soul, and no way improve his opinion.
Fare thee well, remain thou still in darkness. Thou shalt hold the opinion of Pythagoras, as e'er as I will now with my wits. And to kill him would come less, thou dispossess thou soul thy grandam. Fare thee well.
Sir Topis! Sir Topis!
My most exquisite Sir Topis.
Nay, I am for all waters!
Well, thou mightst have done this without the beard and the gown. She sees thee not.
To thee in thine own voice, to her in thine own voice, and report what thou findest. I would be well rid of this knavery. If she may be delivered, I would have it so, for I cannot pursue this with any safety, this sport the upshot. I am so in offense with my niece. Come by and hide my chamber.
Hey, Robin, Charlie Robin, tell me how thy lady does.
Fool!
My lady is unkind, Purdy.
Fool!
Alas, why is she so?
Fool, I say!
She loves another! Who calls, huh?
Oh, good fool, if ever thou wilt deserve well at my hand, help me to some candle, pen, ink, and paper. As I am a gentleman, I will live to be grateful to thee for it.
Master Malvolia?
Aye, good fool.
Ah, oh, alas, ma'am, how fell you beside your five wits?
Fool, never was woman so notoriously abused. I am well in my wits, as thou art.
Well, you were mad indeed if you were no better in your wits than a fool.
They keep me here in dark, they property me, keep me here in darkness, send ministers to me, asses, and do all that they can to face me out of my wits.
Advise what you say, the minister is here. Malvolia, Malvolia! Thy wits the heavens restore! Endeavor thyself with sleep and leave thy vain bibble babble!
Sir Topis!
Maintain no words, good fellow!
Who, I, sir?
Not I, sir! God buy you, Sir Topis! Marry all men!
I will, sir, I will!
Fool! Fool! Fool, I say!
Alas, ma'am! Be patient! What say you, ma'am? I am sent for speaking to you.
Good fool, there's never woman thus abused, I promise. I am well in my wits as any woman in Illyria.
Well a day that you were, ma'am.
Oh, good fool. Convey what I will set down to my lady. It shall advantage thee more than e'er the bearing of letter did.
I will help you to it. But tell me true. Are you not mad indeed, or do you counterfeit?
Believe me, I am not. I tell thee true.
Nay, I never believe a mad woman till I see her brains. I will fetch you light and paper and ink.
I requite this in the highest degree. I pray thee, be gone.
I am gone, ma'am, and anon, ma'am. I will meet you again, like a trice to the old vice or need to sustain, with a dagger of wrath and his rage and his wrath, cries, aha, to the devil. Like a mad lad, tear thy nails down, a do-good man, devil. Ha, 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 ha.
This is the air. That is the glorious sun. This pearl that she gave me, I do feel it and see it. And though 'tis wonder that it warps me thus, yet 'tis not madness. Where's Antonio? I could not find him at the Elephant, and yet there he was. And there I found this credit, that he did range the town to seek me out. His counsel now might do me cold and stern. For though my conscience disputes well with my sense that this may be some error, but 'tis not madness, yet doth this accident, this flood of fortune, so far exceed all ensign, all discourse, that I am willing to distrust mine eyes, and wrangle with my reason that persuades me to any other trust but that I am mad. Or else the lady's mad. Yet, if it were so, she could not sway her house, command her followers, take and give back affairs and their dispatch with such strong, discreet, and stable bearing as I perceive she does. There's something in it that's deceivable. But here, the lady comes.
Blame not my haste of mind and be me well. Now go with me and this holy man into the chantry by. There before him, under the consecrated roof, might be the full assurance of your faith that my most jealous and too doubtful soul may finally be at peace. He shall conceal it. Whiles you are willing, it shall come to note. But we our celebration will keep according to my birth. What do you say?
Madam, I will.
Oh, good father, lead the way, and heaven so shine that they may fairly note this act of mine.
Now, as thou lovest me, let me see her letter.
Good master, baby, grant me another request.
Anything.
Do not desire to see this letter.
This is to give a dog, and in recompense desire my dog again.
Belong you to the Lady Olivia, friends?
Aye, sir. We are some of her trappings.
I know thee well. How dost thou, my good fellow?
Truly, sir, the better for my foes and the worse for my friends.
That's just the contrary. The better for thy friends.
No, sir, the worse.
How can that be?
Marry, sir, they praise me and make an ass of me. Now, my foes, sir, they do plainly tell me that I am an ass. So by my foes, sir, I do profit in the knowledge of myself, and by my friends, I am abused. So conclusions to be as kisses. If your four negatives make your two affirmatives, why then, the worse for my friends and the better for my foes.
Why, this is excellent.
By my troth, sir, no. Though it please you to be one of my friends,
thou shalt not be worse for me. There's gold.
Here comes the man, sir, that did rescue me.
That face of his I do remember well, yet when I saw it last, it was besmeared as black as Vulcan in the smoke of war. What's the matter?
Orsino, this is that Antonio. Here in the streets, desperate, a state in shame, and private robbers like we apprehend him. He did me kindness, sir, drew on my side,
but in conclusion put strange speech upon me. I know not what 'twas but distraction.
Notable pirate, thou saltwater thief, what foolish boldness brought thee to their mercies, whom in terms so bloody and so dear hast made thine enemies?
Orsino, noble sir, be pleased I shake off these names you give me. Antonio never yet was thief or pirate, though I confess on base and grounds enough Orsino's enemy.
When came he to this town?
Today, my lord, and 3 months before. No entrance, not a minute's vacancy. Both day and night did we keep company.
Here comes the countess. Now heaven walks on earth. But for thee, fellow, thy words are madness. 3 months this youth hath tended upon me, but more of that anon. Take him aside.
What would my lord, for that he may not have, wherein Olivia may seem serviceable? Cesario, you do not keep promise with me, madam.
Gracious Olivia.
What do you say, Cesario, good my lord?
My lord would speak, my duty hushes me.
If it be aught to the same old tune, it be as fat and wholesome to my ears, howling after music.
Still so cruel.
Still so constant, Lord.
What? To perverseness? You? Uncivil lady, whose in great and unauspicious altars my soul, the faithless offerings breathe down that air devotion tender. What shall I do?
Even what so pleases my Lord that shall become him.
Why should I not? Had I the heart to do it, like to the Egyptian thief at point of death kill, would I love? A savage jealousy that sometimes savors nobly, but hear me this. Since you do not regard its cast, my faith in that, I partly know the instrument that screws me from my true place in your favor. Live you, the marble-breasted tyrant. Still, but this, your minion, whom I know you love, and whom by heaven I swear I tender dearly, him will I tear out of that cruel eye where he sits crowned in his master's spite. Come, boy, with me. My thoughts are ripe in mischief. I'll sacrifice the lamb that I love to spite a raven's heart within a dove.
And I, most jocund, acted willingly to do rest a thousand deaths would die. Where goes Cesario? After him that I love. More than I love these eyes, more than I love life, more by all more than air, I shall love wife. If I do feign these witnesses, my witnesses above, punish my life for tainting of my love.
I me detested, how am I beguiled?
Who does beguile you? Who does do you wrong?
Hast thou forgot thyself? Is it so long? Call forth the Holy Father.
Come away.
Whither, my lord? Cesario, husband, stead.
Husband?
Aye, husband. Can that he deny?
Her husband? Sirrah?
No, my lord, not I.
Alas, it is the baseness of thy fear that makes thee strangle thy propriety. Fear not, Cesario, take thy fortunes up, for that thou knowest thou art that would be as great as that thou fearest. Welcome, father. Good father, I charge thee by thy reverence here untold, though lately we intended to keep what occasion now reveals before 'tis ripe. What dost thou know hath newly passed between this youth and me?
A contract of an eternal bond of love, confirmed by the mutual joining of your hands, attested by the whole close of lips, strengthened by the interchangement of your rings, and for the ceremony by this compact, sealed in my function and my testimony. Since then, my watch hath told me, toward my grave, I have traveled but 2 hours.
Oh, thou dissembling cub! What wilt thou be when time hath so to grizzle on thy case? Will not else thine own craft so quickly grow that thine own trip shall be thine overthrow? Farewell, take her, but direct thy feet where thou and I henceforth may never meet.
My lord, I do protest.
Oh, do not swear. Hold little faith, though thou hast too much fear.
For the love of God, assert. Oh, please send one presently to Sir Toby.
What's the matter?
Hath broke my head at cross and has given Sir Toby a bloody coxcomb too. For the love of God, your help. I'd rather than 40 pounds, I would hope.
Who has done this, Sir Andrew?
The Count's gentleman was Cesario. We took him for a coward, but he's a very devil incarnate.
My gentleman, Cesario.
Odds lifelings, here he is, has broke my head for nothing, and that I did I was set on to do by Sir Toby.
Why do you speak to me? I never hurt you.
You drew your sword upon me without cause, but I bespake you fair and hurt you not.
If a bloody coxcomb be a hurt, you have hurt me. I think you said nothing by bloody coxcomb. Here comes Sir Toby halting. You shall hear more. But if he had not been a drink, he would have tickled you other gates than he did.
How now, gentlemen? How is it with you?
It is all one. Has hurt me, and there's an end on it. Sod, hast thou seen the surgeon?
Oh, he's drunk, Sir Toby. An hour gone. His eyes were set at 8 a.m.
He is a rogue and a peasy measuring paven. My hate a drunken rogue.
Away with them! Who hath made this havoc with them?
I'll help you, Sir Toby, because we'll be dressed together.
Will you help an ass, a coxcomb, a knave, a thin-faced knave, and a gull?
Get him to bed, and let his hurt be looked to.
I'm sorry, madam, that I hurt your kinsman. But had it been a brother of my blood, I must have done no less but with wit and safety. You throw a strange regard upon me, and therefore I perceive it hath offended you. Oh, pardon me, sweet one, even for the vows we have made each other but so late ago.
One face, one voice, one habit, and two persons. A natural perspective that is, and is not.
Antonio! Oh, my sweet Antonio, how the hours have racked and tortured me since I have lost thee!
Sebastian, are you...
Fearest thou, Antonio?
How have you made division of yourself? An apple-clever too is not more twin than these creatures. Which is Sebastian?
Most wonderful.
Do I stand there? I never had a brother. Nor can there be any deity in my nature here and everywhere. I had a sister, whom the blind ways and surges have devoured. Of charity, what kin are you? What name, what countryman, what parentage?
Of Messaline. Sebastian was my father, and such a Sebastian was my brother, too. So weigh me to his watery tomb. If spirit does assume both form and suit, you come to fright us.
Spirit I am indeed, but am in that dimension grossly clad, which from the womb I did participate. Were you a woman as the rest goes even, I should my tears let fall upon your cheek and say thrice welcome drowned Viola.
My father had a mole upon his brow.
And so had mine.
And died that day when Viola from her birth had numbered 13 years?
Yes, that record is lively in my soul. He finished it indeed his mortal act that day that made my sister 13 years.
If nothing less to make us happy both, but this my masculine usurped attire, do not embrace me until each circumstance of place, time, fortune do cohere and jump that. I am Viola. Which to confirm, I'll bring you to a captain in this town where lie my maiden weeds, by whose help I was preserved to serve this noble count. All the occurrence since has happened between this lady and this lord.
So comes a lady, you have been mistook. You could have been contracted to a maid. Nor are you therein by my life deceived. You have been betrothed to both a maid and a man.
Be not amazed, for I noble is his blood. If this be so, as yet the glass seems true, I shall have shared this most happy rack. Boy, thou hast said to me 1,000 times thou shouldst never love woman like to me.
And all those sayings I will overswear, and all those swearings keep as true in soul as doth that orbit continent the fire that severs day from night.
Give me thy hand. Let me see thee in thy woman's weeds.
The captain that did bring me first on shore hath the maid's garments. He, upon some action, is at Malvolia's suit. A gentlewoman and follower of my lady's.
She shall enlarge her. Fetch Malvolia hither. And yet, alas, now I remember me. They say, poor gentleman, she's much distract. A most extracting frenzy of mine own. From my remembrance, clearly banished hers. How does she, sirrah?
Truly, madam. She holds me as above stage's ends as well as any mad woman in her case may do. Has here writ a letter to you? I should have given you today morning, but her epistles are no gospel, so it skills not much when they are delivered.
Open it and read it.
Well, to be well edified, Madonna, as the fool delivers the mad woman. By the Lord, madam!
Now, mark that.
No, Madonna, I do but read matters. Therefore, if you have it as it ought to be, you must allow box.
Prithee, read in thy right wit.
So I do, Madonna, but to read in thy right wits is to read thus. Therefore, prepare, my princess, and give ear.
Read it, Yusrah.
By the Lord, madam, you wrong me, and the world shall know it. Though you have put me into darkness and given your drunken cousin rule over me, yet have I the benefit of my senses as well as your ladyship.
I have your own letter that induced me to the seventh to put on, with the which I doubt not but to give myself much right or you much shame. Think of me as you please. I leave my duty a little unthought of and speak out of my injury. The madly used Malvolia.
Did she write this?
Aye, madam.
Savors not much of distraction.
See her delivered. Fabian, bring her hither. My lord, so please you, these things thought further on, to think me as well a sister as a wife. One day shall crown the alliance, so please you, here at my house and at my proper cost.
Madam, I most apt embrace your offer. Is this the mad woman?
Aye, my lord, sing. What ho, Malvolia?
Madam, you have done me wrong. Notorious wrong.
Have I, Malvolia? No.
Yes, lady, you have. Pray you peruse this letter. You must not now deny it is your hand. Why have you suffered me, kept me imprisoned in a dark house, sent a priest to me, and made the most notorious geck and gull that e'er invention laid on? Tell me why.
Alas, Malvolia, 'tis not my writing. Though I confess much like the character, but out of question 'tis Maria's hand. And now I do bethink me it was she that first told me thou was mad and camest in smiling, and in such forms which were presupposed upon thee in the letter. Prithee, be content. This practice hath most shrewdly passed upon me. But when we know the grounds and authors of it, thou shalt be both the plaintiff and the judge of thine own cause.
Good madam. Hear me speak, and let no quarrel nor no brawl to come taint the condition of this present hour, which I have wondered at in hopes it shall not. Most freely I confess myself and Toby set this device against Malvolia here upon some stubborn and uncourteous parts we had conceived against her. Maria read the letter of Sir Toby's great importance in recompense whereof he hath married her. How with a sportful malice it was followed, may rather pluck on laughter than revenge, if that the injuries be justly weighed that have on both sides passed.
Alas, poor fool, how they have baffled thee.
Why, some are born great, some achieve greatness, and some have greatness thrust upon them! I was one, madam, Sir Tulpeth, madam, but that's all one. By the Lord, fool, I'm not mad. But do you remember? How can you smile at such a barren rascal and smile not he's gagged? Well then, the world gang of times brings his revenges.
I will revenge on the lot of you.
She hath been most notoriously abused.
Pursue her, and treat her to a peace. She hath not told us of the captain yet. When that is known, and the golden time commence, a solemn combination shall be made of our dear souls. Meantime, sweet sister, we shall not depart from hence. Come, Cesario, for so you shall be while you are man. But when another habits you are seen, Orsino's mistress, and his fancy's queen!
But a toy, for the rain it rained every day. But when I came to Mexico, it makes it deep and suffer big. For the rain it rained every day. For the rain it rained every day. But when I came
for the rain it rained every day. For the rain it rained.